meeting.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to call to order the special meeting December 8th, 2014. It is special because we postponed the last Monday one. So this agenda cannot change. So I'd like to call it to order and begin with an approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Approval of the minutes from the regular November meeting, 11:03.
Move their adoption as drafted.
Aye, second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Citizen comments, are there any? Anything that we need? I'll give it just a very, very brief report. Two little things. The steep plan that was mentioned in the November meeting, we did complete that application. We applied to the state for $500,000 for the new transfer station. We had an identical application that went in from the town of Sharon for the same amount of money. So hopefully those two will be realized, and that would be a big help for us going into next year. So we'll keep our fingers crossed. And then I'd just like to thank everybody for last night's, first of all the trees that have been put up and lit up over the past 2 weeks, and then last night's ceremony was pretty nice at the White Hart, and a lot of work went into the tree and the ambulance dedication, and so just thank you all for that. So moving into old business, we only have one item, which is wild and scenic designation for the Housatonic that's been before us for quite a while. And I think we've decided more or less to have a town informational meeting sometime in the winter about that. And in the meantime, if you have any thoughts on that.
I just would say that there's been a lot of discussion about the designation, wild and scenic, and there's some confusion still about what exactly, what documents are attached to that designation. So we hope to have a town-wide meeting so that this will all become clear to all of us at the same time, I hope. So,
Okay. Jim?
Well, thank you, Curtis.
We just got to finish. Do you have anything on wild and scenic?
I'm sorry, no, I
okay, so I think we're just agreed that we'll go into January or February with an informational meeting about that whole concept. And in the meantime, if you have any specific thoughts, either of you, get them to me so we can get them. Our two representatives remain, George Kiefer and Gordon Whitbeck, who've been on for years, and we'll follow their lead as well. 7A.
Okay.
I'm going to turn this over to Jim Dresser because he's asked for this to be on the agenda.
Thank you, Curtis. Let me just tee this up a bit. A little background on how we got here, and then I want to introduce some people who will give you some more information. The executive summary of the Affordable Housing Advisory Committee report in 2010 begins, quote, "Salisbury is becoming an upscale retirement community." In fact, as a local WAG has described our town as a place where old folks come to visit their parents, and not totally inaccurate. The report continues, "It's characterized by the state's least affordable housing market outside Fairfield County, an exodus of young adults and young families, declining school enrollments, the oldest median age of any town in Connecticut, and aging workforces at local businesses." It goes on to say, "If young adults and families are unable to find adequate housing, they will move to areas that provide it, thereby reducing the diversity of our population and impacting the vitality of our businesses and volunteer services. The town must ensure an adequate supply of housing of different types, such as single family, rentals, and condominiums, at different price levels that citizens can move through over their lives." This latter statement is what we call the housing ladder, which many of us have climbed since we first entered the housing market. The problem in Salisbury is that we're missing the lower rungs of the housing ladder, particularly one and two bedroom rentals. Preliminary results from the inventory of rentals that the Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission has been conducting over the recent months indicates that there are fewer than 75 affordable rental units in town with an occupancy rate of 99%. It's hard to climb a ladder if you can't get on it. In recent years, several groups have worked to bring the need for affordable housing to the attention of our citizens. Two affordable housing committees have been appointed by the Selectmen. It's good to see Tony Scoville in the next to the back row over there, the primary author of the first of these. The second, the advisory committee, whose report I quoted from earlier, recommended the creation by ordinance of a Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission, which the town did 3 years ago. The ordinance charges the commission, quote, to advocate for the provision of affordable housing for all our citizens, end of quote, and, quote, to act as local sponsor for nonprofit and private developers willing to develop housing in Salisbury. It mentions examples of commission roles as identifying available land, assisting with the planning and zoning process, recommending dispersals from the Salisbury Affordable Housing Fund, and developing townwide and neighborhood support, end of quote. As a member of the commission, most of whose members are here this afternoon, I'm here to provide an introduction to Women's Institute for Housing and Economic Development. The commission's become impressed with Women's Institute's capability to produce and maintain workforce housing in small communities, including the expansion of Sharon Ridge and two projects in Salisbury. The commission's worked with Women's Institute in recent months to refine the proposed development we're going to talk about today. I have signed a memorandum of understanding with the Women's Institute under which I am donating 5.37 acres with a perfectly legal access that I own off East Railroad Street, east of the rail trail in the village of Salisbury, on which the Women's Institute proposes to build approximately 30 units of workforce rental housing. I'd like to introduce Ellen Flanagan, the Senior Development Manager for Women's Institute, and Brock Williams, Project Manager, to introduce their team and to say a few words about their organization. While I have no financial interest in this transaction, I am going to recuse myself from the rest of the discussion for the sake of appearances. Thank you. Ellen, Brock?
We have packages. So, as Jim just mentioned, I am Ellen Flanagan, Senior Finance Manager for Women's Institute. This is Brock Williams, Project Manager with me. We are a mission-driven nonprofit organization.
I wonder if you might come up for
the table. Do you want to stand?
Can you see if that's on?
Shelters, but we've expanded from there to into affordable housing across the board, not just for women, but for people, actually of many different income ranges, which we won't address today. We have been in Connecticut for the last 12 years. We own over 246 units across the state in Connecticut, including our six-unit Lakeview housing development on Millington Road. I don't know if you're familiar with it. We also own another approximately 75 units in the state of Massachusetts that we own and operate. all of our projects have an independent management firm. We don't manage, but we do the development, the capital financing, and we see the project through construction. So over the past few years, we are a member of the Housing Us Board. I'm not sure if you know, it's the Tri-State Area Board, New York, Massachusetts, Connecticut. Jocelyn Ayer, David Rich, Jennifer Dowley from Berkshire Deconic are some of the members with us to study and determine what is needed in not only the northwest corner of the state, but Salisbury as well. That's how we came upon the Salisbury Housing Affordable Commission that encouraged us to look into the Lakeview housing, and we purchased that through a loan from LISC. And Brock here, the project manager, has been developing it and renovating it. So we came upon, you know, this piece of property at Jim's encouragement, and we put together a team. We're looking at what we need to do, who we're going to serve, workforce housing, what the income ranges will be.
Oh, I'll introduce our team, but first of all, we'd like to say, you know, we're really excited about this opportunity to potentially develop this project for workforce affordable rental housing here in Salisbury. And the idea of this project really came to fruition in cooperation with the Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission. And this whole project would be possible without, you know, Jim's generous donation. You know, the facilitation of the project with his generous donation of the land here. But as a preliminary development efforts, we put together this team. We think a great team here behind me. And I'll introduce Tom R. Carey is the architect, principal of Prison Barrier of R. Carey, Farmington, Connecticut. And then we have Emily and Charles Vale here, attorney, local attorneys here in Salisbury. And then our engineer, Pat Hackett. And Tom actually will take this opportunity to show you a few of the diagrams and drawings we have, mainly with the right-of-way access routes onto the property.
I just have one quick question. How do you define affordable and workforce? Maybe this isn't the time to ask that.
I can give you an overall.
Just a general.
Big general. It's based, it's income-based.
Okay.
So we look anywhere from affordable, the definition is usually 80% of the income or lower. You go up to 100%, depending upon the financing sources that we utilize.
Okay. Thank you. Great, thanks. My name is Tom R. Carey. As Brock pointed out, I'm the principal with Quisenberry R. Carey Architects, and we're out of Farmington, Connecticut. Our firm is a medium-sized firm specialized in doing market rate affordable housing, and primarily all of our work is here in the state of Connecticut. We were engaged by Jim and the Women's Institute to put together a vision for the project and what we think could be very viable for the site in question. The site in question is this being Route 44. And here is
just turned around.
That's great, isn't it? Use your imagination.
Let me just say one thing, Tom. This meeting is a selectman's meeting. It's not a hearing. It's not a public hearing. I'm sure there will be one or more of those, but for now, we're just gaining information, and we will ask Tom to turn this around as soon as we've looked at it.
So the blue spot, that's the parcel.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the blue spot is the parcel, and it is directly behind the properties on East Main Street. It's at the end of Railroad Street, and this is the rail trail, this silver line, and here's Fowler Street. And the parcel is 5.37 acres.
Now you might turn it around.
Yeah.
Yep. Is that okay? Just hold it up.
So this is the plan. This is Route 44, which is the main street. Here is Railroad Street, this being where LeBond is. And then this is the rail trail. So the parcel is 5.5 acres approximately, directly behind the properties on East Main Street. The concept we put together was to, well, this is looking north is to your right. Here is the rail trail. Here are the parcels adjacent to Main Street. The concept is based on a relatively pocket neighborhood, a relatively dense development, pocket neighborhood, where we would have a variety of smaller structures, which could have anywhere from 3 to 5 units in each structure, and ideally some sort of manor house that matches the scale of the other structures in the community. All of the houses would be relatively small in scale, 1 or 2 stories maximum. And again, we would focus on keeping the scale of the structures relatively small. We would have access on the site, which is one way, which allows us to make the roadways very narrow, with parallel parking along one side, which again reinforces sort of the village type of approach, with a small central green and community space. The site itself, and Pat can talk a little bit more about it as necessary, is relatively wet. There's a conservation area to one side of the site, and we're staying well within the boundaries of that conservation area. So here is the proposed site. This is the rail trail right now. Here are the parcels directly behind East Main Street. North is to the right. The concept is to create this little village, which is centered around sort of a small open space and community room. So the structures would have anywhere from 2 to 5 units within the structures. The total development would have 30 units right now.
And I just want to reiterate, this is just the development concept, so nothing's really cast in stone.
That is important to point out. Again, this is a vision for what the development could be, and it will go through numerous iterations. And one of the issues, primary issues we will be talking about, is the need for access to the development, and the desire to create an extension from East Railroad Street on a small portion of the rail trail so that we can develop a formal access drive to the site and off of the site. Currently, the parcel has an access, a right-of-way, that runs partially through these two adjacent properties and a structure, which is realistically physically unviable. So we would be looking for ultimately permission to put this access road on the rail, a small portion of the rail trail. Finally, this is a concept vision or image of what the development would look like. And this is very preliminary, but you can see that it's relatively small structures clustered together to create a very human scale streetscape, a walking community, and a central green.
And that, the rail trail ends on the lower.
The rail trail is right across the bottom of the site. And this is just a vision image of what the development might look like.
And where's the...
The rail trail is down here. And really, that's where we are at this point. Again, we're very early in the planning stages. We have a lot of information to do, a lot of information gathering to do. We look forward to working with our partners. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good. Well,
probably a lot of questions. I suspect.
I'm Benny Clino.
Okay.
Yes.
I just like to.
Want me to take that?
Sure. So I will be brief, because you have a crowded agenda. Jim referenced this document, which I think you're all familiar with, and expresses extremely well the needs that we have, and need in the sense that we lack it, and we would like to fill that need. We recently, Planning and Zoning Commission had done their statutory duty and produced the POCD, the Plan of Conservation and Development for the town. And from what I know of the project and from what you've heard today, I would just make a couple of comments. The POCD ranked by category things of importance along a whole area of conservation and traditional development issues. And they were graded really A, B, and C. The A grades for strategies was to collaborate with the Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission, which is now a town of Salisbury Commission. This is the charge, I guess, for the vision of the Planning and Zoning Commission. This is what we're talking about. To promote pedestrian improvements in the center of Salisbury, to improve the bike path between Salisbury and Lakeville, and to coordinate with the Water Pollution Control Authority, the former sewer commission, in planning for expanded sewer services to define contiguous areas in the village of Salisbury. And their charge really is also to enhance village centers when planning for village centers, maintain communication among planning and zoning, the Selectmen, the Salisbury Affordable Housing Commission, the Scenic Road Committee, property owners, merchants, and others who are interested. So I think what this project brings is a partial satisfaction of some of these objectives that the town has endorsed through one or other of its agencies. And what we're asking for here, to be specific, is a request of the Selectmen to actually host an information meeting. This clearly, the people who are here would like to hear more, see more about this. So we are asking that you, the Selectmen, would sponsor an information meeting to hear more details about the workforce housing issue here, represented with this proposal for 30 rental units, and so that we can find out more about and request additional information about the project, and particularly with the issue of the what I'm calling the enhanced access that we would like to find. Because although the access we have is legal, it can be enhanced. It could be better. And for that, we would need town action to help us out. So I'm advised that Patty Williams told us that December 18th, which is a Thursday, is an open date. I'm suggesting that to you. And we hope that by scheduling this meeting, that you as a board will evidence your consideration of this matter to a further point, and that we only ask that you be willing to consider what we say and about the expansion of the right of way, and possibly at some future point hold a town meeting, which of course has the final say about the disposition of public property. So those are my requests. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a generous offer, Jim, and I think it's a very generous move on your part. But I have no problem with it. I think with December 18th as a night to have a public forum for this. Charlie, what do you expect the town procedures would be with development like this in terms of different commissions and committees? And
well, we've just begun the process here by talking to you, because without an enhanced access, the project has some lacks, some planning deficits. But the next step, I mean, if it's possible and if it's well received, We were actually, Emily is representing the Women's Institute tonight in a preliminary view before the Conservation Commission, which is the Inland Wetlands Agency, which has regulatory control authority over any wetlands issues, if there are any. And we were planning to make an appearance before the Planning and Zoning Commission on the 16th, but they canceled their meeting. I don't think they knew we were coming, but we had been internally planning to make a presentation to them. So we will make a presentation to them at their first meeting in January.
In January.
So in a month's time, the two relevant agencies who have regulatory authority will at least have a preliminary look. We are not formally before either one and won't be for some time until we can prepare a proper application. And we really can't do that until we kind of know which way the wind's blowing on the rail trail.
With the town access.
Yes.
Okay.
So, right. A bit of chicken before the egg, but we are open and we will tell you what we can tell you at a very early stage, anything that's relevant, and perhaps people could let us know or let you know if they have particular concerns. It would be nice to know what particular questions can be answered so we don't get seem like we're quite. We can do the research, we just need to know what to research.
Can I just say something?
Yeah, please.
This is Kitty. I'm used to thinking of a microphone as needing to know who I am. When I first came back into town, I served on the Affordable Housing Trust, and then I've also served on the Affordable Housing Commission. And so my bias is very, very, very pro workforce housing. And I'd like to just sort of put that out there. I know that there's probably going to be a motion, perhaps made by me, to have an information meeting on December 18th, but I won't be here. So I just want to say now how supportive I am of this.
Let's just hold off on any questions for a minute until we get. Do you want to make that motion?
I will make a motion. Make a motion that the Selectmen host an information session to hear and discuss the Women's Institute for Housing and Economic Development proposal for workforce rental housing on Thursday, December 18th, 2014, at 7:30 p.m. at the Town Hall here, 27 Main Street in Salisbury.
I second that.
Okay.
A member of the Planning and Zoning Commission just passed me a suggestion.
I'm just on behalf of
the we all wear several hats, but I mean, she did make a good suggestion that perhaps we can have some sort of an accommodation for Saturday morning for all the people who were not here.
I'm talking about the information session.
Yeah, the information session.
A second one?
Well, we don't know.
We could do a second one.
You want to do a second one?
You want to do two?
Well, why not?
If you can, do two.
More. Okay.
More chances.
We have one motion on the table.
So one at
the one motion.
It's informational, so yeah. It's not a vote. One question is on the newspaper, but...
why don't you go ahead with that one,
and yeah.
Our group will come together voluntarily, and if you could provide the town hall to us on a Saturday morning, we can answer such questions as they are on a voluntary basis.
Okay. So let's go ahead with the Thursday one. Sally?
You know, Curtis, I'm the abutter through the home of the easement runs. This has caused a lot of discussion in our neighborhood, and December the 18th is exactly 1 week before Christmas Day, and it's already caused stress to a lot of people just to think about it, and to have a meeting scheduled that was informational 1 week before Christmas seems a little, I was informed that it was going to be the 8th of January, and I think that's something kind of we've been shooting around in our conversations in the neighborhood. I ask you to reconsider that date. It's proximity.
What have you thought of us having two informational meetings? One on that Thursday and another one subsequently. Again, these are informational meetings.
I understand that.
As a human being who sort of listens to gossip occasionally and tries not to, I think it's best to get as much information out immediately as possible, and then have another meeting after. But since there are very few people in this room compared to the population of the town, and I'm sure that everyone is extremely interested in this, so I would encourage us to have a public meeting where, this being a town selectman meeting, we can't just discuss it endlessly, but we can in an information meeting. So I would encourage us to have a meeting quickly, and then also have another meeting after, mm-hmm. With the same basic format.
Possibly on a Saturday.
On a Saturday. That's just my thought.
Okay. Motion to approve. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so we will have an informational meeting. We will post one here on the 18th, and then we'll have no action at that time. There's no selectmen's action. There's no town meeting action. It's simply a little bit expansion of this, that where the public get a chance to speak. So, because it's kind of awkward for us, we're in the middle of the selectmen's meeting. So I think we should give everyone a chance to hear this at least once, and probably twice or three times, mm-hmm. in addition to any commission actions. So, okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Salisbury. Their parents donated the land underneath the community garden, daycare center, and the nursing group. And they have also been involved in the little ski hill, which is sort of fallen into disrepair, called Bittersweet, off to the north of the ski jump. And they also, years ago, were involved in the first big land acquisition for the Appalachian Trail. Chris recently wrote a letter, and I'm going to read this letter. You and I have been discussing a purchase by the town of two properties owned by Pope Family Properties. The fields and wetlands along Salmon Kill Road, sometimes called the Rose Lots, and the ski hill. With this letter, I hope to clarify the family's hope for the outcome of this sale. My understanding from you is that while the town has no specific plan for the piece along Salmon Kill Road at this time, low-income or mixed-income housing along with additional sports facilities is currently high on your list. Permanently affordable housing has been an interest of ours and my parents for many years, and we feel that this usage would benefit the town in many ways. We hope that as the town considers the future use of this property, permanently affordable housing will be a major element of its development. Many years ago, my father allowed Swasa to construct the Bittersweet Ski Hill on part of his mountain property, and we've been happy to allow that arrangement to continue. Sadly, the facility has recently fallen into disrepair. We are delighted that the town wants to acquire and revitalize this asset. Although I'm not too familiar with the terrain, it seems possible that, with the additional acreage mapped out by Matt Kiefer,
to connect with the ski jump property. There might be additional runs that could be created to the right of the toe as one looks uphill. Our understanding is that together these properties are worth $1.6 million, and I believe you feel this purchase is doable from the town's point of view. Please let me know if this agrees with your understanding of our discussions, Chris Pope. So, we obviously have heard from many people over the years about this property. It's 50 acres plus along Salmon Kill. It includes 20 acres of the hay fields next to the nursing facility and the garden, and then it includes 30 acres plus of pretty significant wetlands back there where the Mountain Brook and Moore Brook and Factory Brook all come together. It's really a pretty special piece of property, and the ski hill is the tail end of their other property, and it has no legitimate access, but that's an issue that we would work through. It's obviously been used by the town for years. And many people have approached us over the years about the sort of relevance of that piece for the town, both in terms of agriculture, housing, wetlands, you name it.
Recreation,
expanded sports facilities. We're always trying to poke over the line on that with certain projects that we want to do related to Little League and that kind of thing. So I did ask Barbara Bigos, who's currently in Florida, but will be back. She's got the property, it's 56 acres on Salmon Kill. She's got a value on it of almost $1.3 million, and she said that in the reval, it will probably go up to 1.5 or 1.6. We obviously don't have the valuation on the 5 acres over at Swasa because it's not a distinct parcel of property. So again, I think that this is something that we would talk about obviously as a town sometime this winter. I do think that we would have to evaluate this in terms of our budget and our capital needs and where we are with the other projects, which we've already begun to figure out. So I have nothing else to say on that. Any thoughts or comments from either of you?
This isn't meant to be in support of it because we're not that far along for me to have that sort of opinion, but it does remind one of the Louisiana purchase. I mean, it's an incredible large property in the center of our village that only comes up once. And we should all take it very seriously and think about whether we can swing a significant price tag.
Kitty? I agree with what Jim says. I know that, you know, that I'm related to a person who says that's really good agricultural land every time I mention it. So I just have to get that up. I just have to say that for my friend. But I think it's an amazing offer, so we have to take it very seriously.
Mm-hmm. So. We will talk about this, obviously, this winter. And one of the things about the town owning the ski hill instead of Swasa, it would be easier for Swasa to just acquire this somehow, but Swasa can't run the ski hill with their insurance, and we have gotten approval from our insurance agent to, as long as the town owns it, we can run this little ski operation, which is really just a little rope tow with a motor with a cover over it, and many of our kids grew up skiing there, and I think it would be really nice to get it going again. Particularly now that Swasa has more snowmaking ability and we probably have a longer season. So, Robin?
How long's the road through Swasa to the ski hill?
I think that Swasa and I think Roy Sherwood. But we'll deal with all that later. Is that right? Anyway.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. That's it for that. Any other questions on that? Okay, we have a letter, moving on, 7C, from Brian Ciardi.
Curtis, this letter is submitted with the intent of proposing the purchase of the Lakeville train station. As a longtime visitor and now a full-time Salisbury resident, I recognize and respect the historical importance of the building, but feel it could be utilized in a way that would better serve the community. The proposed usage and renovation of the building, including improvements to its perimeter, would be in compliance with the Historical Commission's regulation. The intended use of the building would be for a wellness center focusing on yoga. The business model that would be followed is unique in the industry and would enable people from all economic backgrounds to utilize the facility. Being a benefit to the community as a whole is a major goal of this proposed venture. It's understood that certain procedures may need to be followed in order to purchase the property, with my concern being how much time the process would take. We are prepared to act quickly, if possible, with a cash offer. The intention is for long-term ownership of the building, but in the future, if the building's ever resold, it is our belief that Salisbury should also benefit if there is a profit. Part of our proposal would be for a yet-to-be-determined percentage of any profits after capital improvements to be donated to an organization that provides service to the citizens of Salisbury, i.e. the fire department, ambulance squad, library. A formal proposal to purchase with our cash offer, charitable percentage, and any necessary due diligence will be made available upon any consideration of sales. Sincerely, Brian Ciardi, Salisbury, Connecticut. Thoughts on that, either of you, anybody? This is still a selectmen's meeting, so.
Right. This is pretty much brand new to me, and I think that preserving that little building as its current aesthetic, which looks like an old railroad station, is really a great idea, and I know that if we are open to proposals, this is just the first of many. So I'm very thrilled to get one, and maybe something will now happen with the railroad station eventually.
Okay. Jim?
Ditto.
Okay. I think ditto. I think we would probably maybe move this on to a discussion with planning and zoning in the winter. Mm-hmm. We've been down this road before with uses of public buildings, and seems like they should have the first look at this proposal because they would ultimately be involved with it anyway. Mm-hmm. And we have a few other things to talk to planning and zoning about, like Brook Street, that the Salisbury Association wants us to take that over, things like that. So
under section 824.
Yeah.
Need to look at.
Do you have a Barbara Bigos tax card on this?
I don't know right now, Robin. I'll find out.
That's why you don't have it.
No, I don't have it with me. He didn't provide it. Okay.
Well, it's owned by the town.
It's owned by the town.
It was going to be in a bad way.
She generally has a fairly loose number on town properties because they rarely sell or trade. Okay. Anything else on that? I wanted to just mention both of those. Jim, thanks for covering the Siting Council meeting on the cell tower at Salisbury School. I spoke to them today. They said that the Siting Council, who conducted a hearing here in this building, they've never had, in the history of the state, a hearing where no one was opposed to a cell tower. But that happened last Thursday. That was probably an interesting sign. I asked her if there was anything that the town should do following up, and she said probably not. They have the State Historical and Archaeological Commission is looking into this a little bit, and I think that's fairly routine, and when they're finished with that review, she'll get back to us. But in the meantime, this is a private property and a private cell tower arrangement.
I sat through the meetings last week, and it was, as Curtis and I had talked about, as intervener, we were the only intervener, I simply spoke and talked about the need for cell service in the Taconic area of Salisbury. In the evening, there were 9 citizens here, 4 of whom spoke in favor, as Curtis says. And the chairman did make that interesting announcement. He'd never seen anything like that before. So it was pretty uneventful.
Okay. Kitty, anything on that, Siting Council?
No, I don't.
E, appointments for 2015. We do these every year. I don't think I need to go through the whole list with everybody, but I will mention a few of the commissions that are up for, have been subject to a little bit of discussion. Conservation Commission, Lynn Meehan and Sally Spillane would both be re-upping for a term. I've spoken to both of them. Economic Development Committee, which is Ward Belcher, Tino Galuzzo, Jackie Merwin, and Kathy Shire. They would add Michael Clulo and David Rich. Grove Advisory would stay the same. Historic District, Digby Brown, Leon McLean, Arthur Taylor. Northwest Council of Governments, that's the three of us up here. Park and Forest is one that's been subject to some discussion, and we've had reached out to a new, somewhat new commission, and we are proposing the following group. Gordon Whitbeck stays on because his term isn't up yet, but that the new group would include Emily Vale, Kay Key, Matt Kiefer, Tony Scoble has agreed to stay on, Jay Landon, and Cindy Knoppen. Yep. And that would be a seven-person commission that would be somewhat reinvigorated. Pathways would stay the same. Roger Crane is up for renewal on the Affordable Housing Commission. The Fire Commission would stay the same. Scenic Roads, reappointments for a year. And Special Constables, we have two new ones, Ronald Barnett and Stephen Bartek. Transfer Station Recycling Track, Bob Palmer, Barbara Bedigal, and Ned Harvey, they're long-term members. One new change is Matt Kiefer has taken the course for tree warden, so I'd like to see him appointed. And WPCA would be Joe Brennan, Robin Leach, Peggy O'Brien, and Teal Atkinson. So, any discussion on those appointments from either of you?
I will move those appointments as drafted.
I will second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
So thank you all who stepped up for those, and we'll look forward to reaching out to some of you. Getting you, some of you have to get sworn in if you're a building, if it's a building commission. Meeting dates for the Board of Selectmen continues with Mondays at 4 o'clock. So that will be January through December.
And it's the first Monday of every month except for Labor Day weekend.
Labor Day will be September 14th. So, motion on those?
I move that we accept these dates.
Okay. So I think there's a typo, at least March 3rd to March 2nd.
I don't know.
March
2nd. Good call. Okay.
Yep, March 2nd.
Yeah, March 2nd. But first Monday of the month at 4 o'clock. Yeah, that's the main. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Tax collector refunds, the following from Gene Bell, J.P. Morgan Chase for $51.10, Toyota Motor Credit for $110.98. Approval of those?
I move the tax refunds due to overpayment.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Selectmen reports.
Okay. I have two. The first one is from the work that a couple of us in the town have been doing on trying to figure out internet connectivity and various options. I would like to ask that we, the town, consider using the Nutmeg Network, which is the Connecticut Education Network, CEN, for the town hall. I have put in a preliminary application. The second application allows us to get bids to find out how much it would cost to do some of the work in the town hall. Since we need work done in the town hall anyway,
right,
and this is free money of up to $6,000, I would ask us to apply for it just to see what happens.
Absolutely.
And the only reason I'm bringing it up here is that the first selectman has to sign it. But that's okay with you, Jim.
Jim, you all remember that? I think that's a good idea, so we will.
And I have copies of this if anybody wants to pick it up after.
Okay, thanks. I've already called on Thursday, so we'll probably bring it up then.
Okay.
But we'll get into that.
Okay,
well, thanks, Katie, for that.
And then the other one is Salisbury Pathways. We are having, our meetings are the third Mondays of the month, and they are at 5:30 downstairs in the room of the Fox. And we're doing some great stuff, and I would encourage citizens to come to these meetings. And I know I've got at least one citizen over there who's going to be here. And if we can get more citizens to try and figure out how to talk about pathways in the town, that would be great, because the committee has all sorts of ideas, but we want, now it's time for us to turn to citizens and get some support and ideas.
And those meetings again are
right? The third Mondays of the month. Except when we run into, which we are running into, Washington's birthday and something else. So they're on the website, Salisbury Pathways. And we also have great minutes there with pictures of old pathways and sidewalks, and we have the most elaborate minutes of any town hall. So I encourage you.
Good. Anything else? Jim, any selectmen reports?
No.
Okay. Citizen comments. Tony?
At one point, I think maybe last month, you mentioned the idea that if the town gets a high-speed internet here in the town hall, mm-hmm. possibly connecting the library.
Yes.
Is that still in part of
it? Totally. The first step is to get up and running in the town hall.
Yeah, no, I understand that. Yeah. I just, because it would be great for the library.
The library would be a high priority.
Yeah, yeah. And we hope to get the student hotspots, because I've talked to Region 1. All the towns in Region 1 are on board for getting all their libraries up to have homework hotspots for kids who have not very good internet connection at home. So.
Right.
It's
definitely
a push.
Right.
What's the current option to the town for internet connectivity? I'm surprised the town hall is not already connected.
Comcast.
And you don't want it?
Oh, no. This has got more capabilities, and it also allows us to help the library out. So it's not that we don't want it, it's just we want to look at this and compare. Okay.
Gross.
I just would like to go on record saying, going back to the housing discussion, that the 18th is like being hit over the head with a bat because it's so soon. Mm-hmm. And some of us who live near the proposed changes only heard about this in the last few days. So fine with the 18th, fine with the 8th, but I think it just needs to extend a little bit. Mm-hmm. I think it's just
totally
so
fine.
Rushed.
Yeah, there's no. There's no push on this. There's no, I don't know what the 8th is.
Yeah,
but,
I don't know. Let me clarify if I can, Rose. First of all, I understand exactly what you're saying. That's the purpose of the informational session, is to learn more.
But some
because nothing's
going to
happen. I understand. But that'll be our first opportunity for people who can come to learn more. There is nothing planned for the 8th. Of January, there is nothing, the 8th is today, of December, there's nothing planned in the way of a town meeting. So that's the only thing that's planned is an informational session to start learning more about it, and we'll continue that process until it's run its course. So I agree with you, there isn't any rush.
Yeah, no,
I'd like to say that I think you've appointed a good group for the Black and Brown Solution. And secondly, I have a question. Is that cable TV tower, is that going to be a pine tree or is that going to be a monopole?
I think it's going to be a pine tree, but if you want to weigh in on that, the hearing process is still open.
It is going to be a pine tree.
It's
as correctly proposed when I was there.
An aluminum pine tree.
Whoa, shiny.
Green. So, anyone else? Okay, motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all.